What's he building in there? What's he building in there? We have a right to know.
Welcome back to the confessional. I couldn't resist. What's he building down there by Tom Waits? And not that I'm making a comment on what David does in his basement, but David of Tamisium Extractors is on. And we just want to welcome you, David, to the show. Thanks so much for being on. We are honored to have you.
You know, I didn't have a basement, so I moved to Colorado. Those are all very nice to have.
Well, I'm glad. It kind of there's a little bit of relief for me about that. Welcome, welcome. I wanted to just start off by asking you, I know what the extractors do and what they are, but just for our listeners, could you explain what an extractor is and what it does?
Yeah, well, there's different types of extractors, but the extractor that I built is a solvation extractor. And basically, it's really simple. You're just taking a solid plant material or any material or medium, and you can even do this to dirt or seeds or roots or leaves or flowers or anything, and you're putting it into a liquid solution, and you're using time and temperature to enable the effectiveness of that particular solvent to dissolve it based on its polarity, to dissolve the compounds that are in the plant material. And then you're filtering the plant material out, and you're replenishing that plant material again with another volume of clean solvent, and you're repeating that process 2 to 3 times to ensure that you've washed everything out of the plant that was dissolved with the temperature and the time input that you put into it.
Wow. And that's, that's kind of a mouthful. And it's a brainful, too, when you think about how much is involved with that. And if we had maybe 3 or 4 hours, I would go into deep technical detail about that. But in essence, it seems to me that your extractor, and we've had conversations about this, about the quality of it and how it's built, is something that that was part of the reason why I named this show 100% Pure Love. It was part of it because the purity of what you get out of your extractor is just really the top of the line on the market.
Well, purity is part of the process of controlling, or I like to say strangling, the extractor and trying to prevent it from being effective. So mm-hmm. What you're doing is, by limiting its effectiveness, you're targeting specific compounds by avoiding other compounds. Like, for example, wax, you would want to avoid it by not giving the solvent. Since in this case, butane is a nonpolar solvent, wax is nonpolar, butane would dissolve the nonpolar wax out, so if you give it enough time. And since wax and solvents and like sugar and water, you know, sugar dissolves in water better when it's warmer. Since the solvent works better if you give it more time and more heat, you're trying to take those away to prohibit it or to strangle it and keep it from effectively dissolving those compounds out that you're trying to avoid. So in that essence, you're targeting a compound, you're getting a purer product.
Uh-huh. Okay. And when you and I have talked before about what makes your extractor, what makes your machine different and safer, I really was quite taken with the idea that it is a safer mechanism. It's a safer machine. Could you say a little bit about that? Because I think that's just so important.
Well, almost all solvents I've ever dealt with were flammable. So when you use them in an open system, you want to, you know, keep the vapors down and keep your ignition sources, you know, at bay or eliminated. So to be able to put it into a closed system eliminates all of those issues. The problem with the solvents that we use for terpenes and volatile compounds, which are compounds that have low boiling points and boil away at, you know, more easily than a less volatile compound or chemical, is that they're usually, the solvents that we use are under pressure because they have a very low boiling point. The reason you have it under a low boiling point solvent is so that when you remove you'll never have a safe sanitary food recovery pump, food grade recovery pump, you know, that you recover flammable solvents under pressure that, you know, could explode if they leaked out and get ignited. So we were forced to experiment with that. We failed, and that was about 10 years ago. And so I built a system that basically is a distiller. I mean, you use enough solvent so that you perform a complete extraction, you distill it off. But the tanks are built in such a way that it distills so fast, it evaporates the solvent away so fast and recovers it, that it's actually faster than the systems that you see out there today that haven't been optimized and are forced to use recovery machines. So it's actually faster than those machines. So we really, you know, stumbled upon something.
Mm-hmm. What I know, what I've been impressed with is that yours is one of the most pirated mechanisms and designs. And what do you think? I mean, what do people? What is probably the most common question you get from people? And maybe not so much, you know, really super great experts in extraction or in creating these different compounds, but maybe when someone is just starting out and they want to ask questions about, like, you know, how, what about this, what about that? What is probably the most common question you get?
Well, it's you know, what separates us from the rest. Mm-hmm. You know, when you look at two extractors and they're totally different systems, to a layman or novice, he won't even see that there's two different extractors there. And, you know, and this it brings up an interesting point that in this industry, more people have got into the business of extracting than ever before. The business of selling extractors is just skyrocketing. You know, I mean, like, everybody wants to do extractions because there's so much money in it now. Before the NMJ industry, it was, you know, it was kind of unheard of. And, you know, there were a few private individuals that really knew the art, but, you know, not for the most part. And big business didn't want to share what they knew. So, you know, like the recipes of solvents and how to extract. So when these new guys came in, the biggest question is, what is this? How does it work? You know, and why is yours different than another one? So at first, you know, after talking to them for about 5 minutes, they can look at any extractor and they know the difference between one and the other and the pros and the cons, hopefully, you know, what makes one better than the other.
Uh-huh. Yes, and I have to say that, you know, as I've led up to this show and answered some questions from people who've heard, you know, the ad that we created for you, and a couple of people in my life, they're like, he does what? I need that. I need that. I want what he has. And so, you know, I always get kind of clutchy because I would not know how to answer a lot of these technical questions. But, I, you know, I guess that would be the biggest question is, you know, if I'm going to, you know, settle down into one machine and invest in it, you know, how is this investment going to come back to me? And why is it different than everything else?
You mentioned pirating. So when a guy looks at, you know, my system, just like the novice, he doesn't understand what distinguishes this as a superior system. So when he copies it, he doesn't know what parts of that system to carry over, and he creates one that looks very similar to mine, but it's not the same.
Mm.
And there's two key elements that make an extractor superior over another one, and one is that you have to pass an adequate amount of solvent through, and you have to do that. You have to be able to do that quickly or slowly, and you want to control that time. So that means the tank that holds the solvent has to contain all the solvent you want right then at that moment.
Mm-hmm.
And so that allows you to input your temperature and then pass it through the column of plant material as fast or slow as you want it at any temperature with any combination of solvent. If I use an inadequate volumized tank, so it has a less than adequate amount of solvent, then that means that after I pass it through, I'll realize later, maybe years later, that I'm not performing a complete extraction, and I have to recover that solvent and then loop it back through again, and that's what a loop process is. So we're not a loop process. A loop process is an indication that somebody built a system that doesn't know what they're doing, and they used a smaller than necessary tank, and they were probably had a lot in circulation, or maybe they put a lot of time into the modifications of pumps or heaters or whatever, and now they're forced to make that thing work. And so they ended up borrowing that HVAC unit from the air conditioning industry to make that work.
Oh, okay.
The second key point is that when you pass the solvent through, you want to be able to, you know, recover it so you can reuse it again, and you want to do that safe.
Now, David, how long have you been... I guess my two questions next are, how long have you been doing this, and what made you decide, yeah, this is, you know, this is what I want to do. I want to build these things, I want to design this, and I want to market them.
I've been doing this about 20 years. Mm-hmm. I bought an extractor a long time ago from Fritz at Eden Labs, and he and I talked a lot on the phone in the beginning stages, and he actually revealed to me that butane was the holy grail of extraction solvents. And I asked him, I said, why don't you make one of those? And he said, because there's no safe way to use butane. And the reason that he said that was because he's a pump guy. And so he's thinking pumps, you know, we don't have a pump for it. So I tried the same thing. I tried the pumps. And what he told me was, if anybody ever figures out how to make a safe one, a safe extractor using butane, they'll have a goose that lays golden eggs because it's the holy grail of extraction solvent.
Well, I guess you can do a little quacking.
Yeah, that was only the day. So I was on that for about 5 or 6 years, and we did use recovery machines, and we did have failures, and we did have a fire, and we did have an explosion, and we gave up on the idea of ever implementing a recovery machine in the process, which forced me to start my project on how to get rid of that recovery machine.
Now, as we look at the extractor that you have now, how many changes would you say in the last 20 years have you gone through to culminate into the machine that you have now?
Every extractor you see out there being sold today that extracts with butane is one that I built before.
Oh.
So you have all of those systems, and so those are, you know, the tall, skinny columns, the short tanks that clamp together with sanitary clamps. You know, we had to keep our costs down during R&D, so we built our systems from off-the-shelf parts. And when we used the pump, we could get away with that. You know, but once we got rid of the pump, the tanks had to be all of the engine, the performance. You know, they had to provide all of the power and the pressure and everything else. So tank design became extremely critical. The height of your column, the width of your column that holds the plant material, the height and width of your evaporator tank, you know, you can evaporate, if you cover the earth with 1 inch of solvent and put so many watts into that square inch, that solvent would evaporate away as fast as if you had 1 inch of solvent in a cup and you put the same watts per square inch into it. So we knew it was about watts per square inch for evaporation.
Wow.
And then you have to condense it in the other tank because it condenses at its boiling point. The butane boils at 32, so it condenses at 32. If you add a little pressure to it, it will condense at a higher temperature. So it creates its own pressure. So you have to factor all these dynamics in with the conduction, the convection, the wattage per square inch. And it took a long time. I mean, we probably had, I don't know, maybe 200-300 changes just on recovery alone.
Wow. It reminds me of Al Green, you know, in High Records when he would cut a track. Sometimes he would do 100 takes, and you know, it sounds like what you the pride and the craftsmanship that you put into your work knows no limits as far as modification and paying attention to detail and making sure that whoever is going to be on the receiving end of this piece of equipment is going to get the best that you can possibly provide and the safest that you can possibly provide.
Well, you know, the hard part, Christine, was that nobody had done this before. So it was new territory. We didn't have an image even of what was right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we didn't know what direction. We didn't even know it could be done. We didn't even know that some of the things that we wanted to do were even things that we wanted to do. You know,
we had
when we saw a capability of the machine, we sometimes had to figure out why it did that.
Okay.
So we didn't have the capability, and then, you know, a machine that was making it, and, you know, get to fine-tune it. We didn't even know what to tune. And so it was a long process. I mean, for example, when we evaporated our solvent away, we were using 6-inch diameter pipe that was coming out of the top of this huge tank because we thought that the steam had to have all this space or it would start to build up a pressure and condense or something, you know. And I didn't really understand a lot about hydraulics 20 years ago as much as I do now, but now I know that's not the case. So we eliminated that pipe, and we put a 3/8 inch line there, and, you know, it was fully capable of doing doing what we wanted to do at pretty much any volume we were operating at. So,
well, that's fantastic.
Yeah, I mean, just so many things. I mean, like removing the ball valve on the bottom of the column wasn't necessary because we had leaks from that, and it was holding this column. But the column was torqued left or right sometimes, you know, so you're always having these issues. And so we eliminated that ball valve using basic principles of what do you call it, Buechner funnel. You don't see a lot of this is above the heads of some guys, but a Buechner funnel is a paper filter that sits on a flat bottom funnel, and the flat bottom has perforations in it so that the liquid can pass through, and the filter paper will, you know, adhere to the bottom of the funnel. So you fill that up with liquid, but the filter paper is so fine that nothing will pass through it unless you create a vacuum on the bottom.
Like a bad coffee filter.
Yeah, so we use that same principle to eliminate the ball valve from the bottom of the column. So as long as the pressure is equalized in the two tanks, the liquid will stay inside the column, and only vapor will pass through, which will vent the bottom of the column, so you don't have to vent it to the top, and it'll fill up hydraulically from above, which keeps it from channeling and coursing through one side or the other.
Wow.
Yeah, so it just goes on and on. Every little part of this, that, you know, months and months in trial and error.
Well, yeah, it reminds me of the, you know, make your end destination in stone, but your path in sand. There's so many ways that you will shift and change, and you know, it. I feel like I'm getting the information and education straight from the Golden Goose. So thank you very much. We are going to go off to break. This hour is just winding up quick. Of course, you're listening to KKNW 1150 AM. The name of our show today is 100% Pure Love, and these two gentlemen deliver it on a daily basis. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the confessional. We have been talking to Robert Halila of Nurse Nancy, and we are now talking to David McGhee of sorry about that. I've been tripping myself up all day. Tamisium Extractors, and I just very pleased to be talking about these things because they just are such great products that produce such great things for people. So, getting back to a little bit about what we were talking about, David, you know, if somebody who, like you said, a novice that needs a little bit of education, what I love about what you're doing is not only are you producing something that people can rely on, it's safe, it's extremely effective. You've been around for 20 years doing this, and you know how other sort of models of this work because you've created many of those models. I love the fact that somebody who is just beginning to have a business that has maybe essential oils or whatever they're marketing, that they can come to you and get some education as well. I mean, that's the feeling I get. Am I right?
Yeah, well, I have no choice. You know, it's a new system and a new technology, and they don't have a reference book to go to. I'm the reference.
Uh-huh. Right. So that's I think that's important because, you know, in a world where we have so many different things, even when you buy a car, sometimes it's hard to get a straight answer. It's hard to get somebody to say, well, you know, this particular part of the harness was chewed up and it was a flaw in the design and we'll take care of it. And this is how it happens. You could literally spend just, you know, I mean, just a ton of houses. You know, we didn't know that the basement was cracked, you know, and oh, look, we've got a big lake down there now. And it seems like with you, you have not only the product, but you've got education and accountability. And unfortunately, it's not that common in our world, but I think it's a great model for other people to see how you do your business.
But once you've passed, you know, 1,000 in sales, and then you get up to 2,000 units sold. The amount of time you can spend with people starts to become less. You know, and I do. I mean, very. You know, at least one thing's cool. You know, not a lot of people call because a lot of people get it. But there are some people out there that, you know, they just don't get it, and they really need to call. And maybe they didn't. So, or they tried to call and I couldn't get back to them. But you know, that's. The hard part is that I can't give that part of the business up to a guy that doesn't fully understand it. And like I do, you could ask 1,000 questions, you know, how do you find somebody that knows the answer to all those questions? I guess I could go with tier one, tier two technical support, or I'm tier three or whatever. You know, but, you know, you brought up a subject of your show, you know, the pure love. And whenever I created this system, the reason that I created the first small tabletop version was so that guys like you and Robert and everybody else could have their own private medicine manufacturing machine.
Mm-hmm.
And it was through a visit to the the jungles of South America and Belize and Guatemala, that, and through guides and learning, that I realized that the medicine world and the plant kingdom is something that we really haven't tapped into, and the guys that we've relied on to bring these medicines to us, they're business guys, you know, so we're probably never going to hear about something that's not going to line their pockets with profit.
Mm-hmm.
And there were, so probably 80 to 90% of what we need to have is still out there. And it's through the use of learning how to use this machine and teaching us how to fortify for ourselves and become self-sustaining in all aspects, especially treating our own illnesses and everything. It was through this machine that I thought I could do that for the rest of the world. And then that evolved into larger machines. I didn't want to get into the business of building these extractors and selling these to my competitors, because I was doing extractions at the time. And later, the business over it took a mind of its own, and it became the source of income for me. You know, so
that's wonderful. Your intention your intention and your love came first. Well, this hour's winding down. David, could you tell people how to get a hold of you, just really quickly, as we wind up?
Yeah, I mean, they can call me directly on my cell. It's 817-726-7525. You can go to my website. It's tamisiumextractors.com, and tamisium is a Latin word that means to filter or sieve, and tamisium is spelled T-A-M-I-S-I-U-M, two M's, T-A-M-I-S-I-U-M. Or you can go to YouTube, and you can type in the best video. You could probably find it by typing in T-E for tamisium extractors, and then 12,000. And you'll find the video about the largest system that we make and a summary of how it operates.
Oh, that's great. Wonderful. Well, listen, thank you so much for being on the show, David. And Robert, I want to say thank you. Blessings to you and both of you. Thank you so much for doing all of the work that you do on the planet. And with Nurse Nancy Delivery, you know, I'm sure that that there is just so much more love to come in the world through this venue. And I am just so pleased and honored to have both of you on. It's been a long time coming. But as we round out the show, I want to say thank you. And I also want to say to everyone out there, enjoy this beautiful holiday season. And remember that you are the light and love of the world. We'll be on next week. Have a great week. From the back to the middle and around again, I'm gonna be there to the end, 100% pure love. From the back to the middle and around again, I'm gonna be there to the end, 100% pure love. From the back to the middle and around again, I'm gonna be there to the end, 100% pure love. From the back to the middle and around again, I'm gonna be there to the end, 100% play. 9, 10, 9, 20, more than 30, baby. I'm giving 100%.